Hey everybody, welcome back to the shop. We're going to work on this front axle today, and we're going to break this down into a couple different videos. We're waiting on some parts for the center section there for the ring and pinion, so we're going to work on the knuckles today. I want to show you guys a bunch of differences about knuckles and axle shafts and how to get those on there correctly. But first thing I do before I do anything, because it's easy to forget, is I put these inner axle seals in, and they go right in here. Now, to get the housing to this position here, I cleaned it out and I put solvent down the tubes and ran rags through there and pushed rags through with bars and stuff. And if you're doing that on your axle and you happen to knock this thing out, this is just to guide your axle shaft. It just kind of sits in that hole. Sometimes you can knock those out, sometimes they're in there real good, but the oil seal holds that in. So if you do happen to knock that out, it's not the end of the world. This side was real tight. That side was kind of flopping. We're going to set it in there. We're going to stake it with a punch. And we're going to put the oil seal in there. So the oil seals, because they go in from the center, they can sometimes be a nuisance. And Willys had like a left and right thread. And you turn the center and it expanded it and it pushed the seals in. And I had one of those a while ago, and it's kind of miserable for putting seals in. And if you don't have them perfect, they can twist in there, and I never liked their way of putting them in. So I've got a little tool that I use to put these in, and makes it easy. You could tap them in easily and feel how they're going, if they're crooked or anything like that. So we're going to get set up, and now when these seals go in, you know, there's a front and back and stuff. And remember, and when we're putting seals in, the spring always goes toward the oil. So you're going to have oil with your ring and pinion. This side here, I don't know if you can see it, there's no spring in there, but it's made like a spring would be in there. And that's the side the spring would be on. So that goes toward the oil. There's a little taper on the seal there. And that will go with the taper and the spring side, which would be a spring if it had one, toward the oil. So it's going to go in like that. I don't know if you can see that, but you'll kind of, when you get your seals and stuff and putting them in, you'll see which way they go. Always remember the spring toward the oil. So let me get my my seal install and set up, and we'll put these in. Okay, here's how I get these seals in. You guys can do it a bunch of different ways, but this is the easiest way that I've found. I've got a piece of 3/4 square bar, and you can see it, it's long. And then on the end, I got just a little weld bead on there, and this will fit into a 3/4 socket. That'll go right in there and it'll hit up against the weld bead. Okay, so I got a seal just in there by hand, you know, just sitting in there, and I send a piece of 3/4 bar through there. Yeah, I think you can see that okay. And then we put the socket on it, and that'll just slide on there. You need something that'll slide on and off. And then you just hold that, and we're going to tap the seal in. Okay, and then when the seal's in, you can take that back out again. So it's just that easy to put those seals in. The next one, just be careful sending this rod through, because you got the seal on that side now. And that side's a little easier because it's just a short tube. And bang the other side in. That's about the easiest way I've found to put them in. But like I say, whatever works for you. You just want to get those in early so you don't forget them. So we're going to get the other seal in. Then we're going to go over to the bench and start talking about knuckles and bearing preload and all that stuff. So I'll be back with you in just a little bit. Okay, while we're working on the housing, we're going to tap our cups in here. Make sure you got a clean bore, and then grab your new bearing cup and just tap it in. Make sure it's seated down nice, and just tap them in. If you want, you could put a little, you know, race cup in there and put it in with that, but they tap in easy with a hammer. Don't overthink it. One time I knew a guy who thought he wanted to press these in his press, and he broke his whole knuckle. Don't overthink it. Just tap them in. Make sure they're seated. And the bottom ones are in already. And we're just tapping these top ones in, and then we'll talk about those knuckles. And again, it's just a simple procedure to tap them in there. Okay, that's ready to accept the bearings and the knuckles next. Okay, everybody, I'm not sure what anybody else is going to be working on, but bear with me for a second. I'll explain some different knuckles to you. We know that this is a CJ3A, but if we roll back to the early CJ2As, the knuckle, it didn't have a top cap on it. This is a very early CJ2A now, and it didn't have a steering arm here. It was the steering arm bolted on and came down. The steering arm was your top cap. Okay, that was the very first edition that was on the MB on the early CJ2A. And then a little bit later on the CJ2As, they came out and they had your top and bottom cap. So you had both caps, and you shimmed the top and the bottom equally to get your preload when you're spinning that on the housing. And then there was no serial number cutoff. It was just when the CJ3A came out, what they did with the knuckle, I don't know if you can see this. Let me see if I can get you in there. Here's the bottom, and here's the top. And it's hard to see, but what they did when they made these knuckles is they added to this area right here 58 thousandths, and they deleted the shims from the bottom. So 3A knuckle, all 3A knuckles and later, this cap surface is going to be 58 thousandths taller than the top one. So that's on the CJ3A. No shims on the bottom, just shim it on the top. Another thing that happened on the CJ3A was, you see these little gussets in here? Okay, on your 2As, your early 2As, and you know, MBs and stuff like that, there was no gussets in here. It was a different casting, the arm was a little bit narrower, and they weren't as strong as this one. And what they noticed was they were having some breakage on these. So they made a whole new casting, and they put these two little gussets in here. And it did make quite a bit of difference, you know, because you got your tie rod in there and you turn all the time. There's a lot of stress on that. So a little bit thicker in through this area and some gussets there. And that made quite a bit of difference. I know there's kind of a lot to think about on your knuckle there, but it just depends which one you're working on. So if you have a 2A, you're going to shim top and bottom. If you have a 3A, you're only going to shim on the top, and 3B and later, and CJ5 and stuff like that. Like I say, the bottom is bigger, so you only shim on the top. And that keeps this knuckle at the right height to accept your axle shaft. So it's kind of critical. If you find shims top and bottom, re-shim it like that equally. And if you find shims just on the top, no big deal, just shim it on the top again. And if I know somebody's going to have bigger tires, or they're going to be off-roading or something like that, and let's say they got a 2A, I find them some later knuckles with that extra little bit of gusset in there. And it's just a stronger knuckle. And for off-road guys and bigger tire guys that want to keep a stock axle, it helps out a little bit. So what we're going to do now is we're going to get this stuff cleaned up. You can see this came, it's still got a little grit in there. We're going to clean these up and clean these bolts up. You see now that's an original bolt and it's got all that grease on it. We're going to clean that. And what we want to do is seal these threads. We want to give this every chance we can to keep the oil inside and not have it leak out. So we'll clean these bolts, get some sealer on them, and we can actually put that bottom back on there. So let me get that these parts cleaned up, and I'll be right back with you. Okay, guys, we're going to loosely put this bottom bearing cap on. And if you remember from previous videos, this is what I like to use for thread sealant. So we're just going to stick a little bit on each bolt. And we're going to get this loosely bolted up here. Got new lock washers on everything because the other ones were kind of worn out and beat up and twisted and stuff. And some of them were opened up and expanded. So all new lock washers. Bolts appear to be in good condition, so we're going to run with them. Okay, and you remember I said they added 58 thousandths of material to that bottom bearing cap boss. I just checked my shim pack for the top, and that comes in at 56 thousandths. I don't know how that's going to be as far as bearing preload, but they usually try and get it, you know, pretty close. You normally won't have too big a difference between the top and bottom. Sometimes when things are worn out, you get into a little bit of a mess, but we're going to see how this works out. we're going to put the 56 thousandths back under the top one, and we're going to see where we're at. Now we're going to get those bearings lubed up, and I've recently come out with a line of lubricants. I've been working with a lubricant company for quite a while now, and I have some knuckle lube ready to hit the market. I've got a winter blend, I've got a summer blend, got an all-season blend. I've got probably the finest transmission transfer case overdrive lube with no extreme pressure additives in it, so it won't harm any of the non-ferrous metal in there. And I have just recently hit, I have the proper steering box lube. We had that mixed up, and I'll be selling that anytime to anybody that needs it. Just got to find some a suitable container to ship it in, because it comes to me in bulk in barrels. So I do have steering box lube, knuckle lube, transmission transfer case lube. It's the proper stuff, it's what you need, and it's here. And we're gonna get going and grease the bearings with the correct knuckle lube, and then we'll be right back and we'll put this knuckle on the housing and we'll check the preload of the bearings. So I'm going to get the bearings lubed up and be right back with you. Okay, here's how I like to assemble the front knuckle here. Got our cap on the bottom. Got our pre-lubricated bearing in there. And we've got our pre-lubricated bearing in the top. Okay. And we just take this and we'll hook it, hook that bottom bearing in. Bring that over on top of the top one. Now, we've got our 56,000 shim pack, which was original on there. And we're going to send that down through. Get that through the bearing. Sometimes you got to fuss with it. Get those shims lined up. Now, I don't have any thread sealer on these because I don't know if that shim pack is going to work. So what we're going to do is put them in dry. If it works, we'll take them out and put some sealer on. If not, we'll change the shim pack and we'll keep going at this until we get the right preload. And when you're checking your preload, you don't want anything on there. You don't want a seal on this side. You don't want anything on there. It's just the knuckle on the bearings. And we'll just tighten this down. We're not going to go crazy. We're just going to tighten it down so it's snug, not loose. Okay, now, I think that's going to be a little too loose. Snug these down a little bit. It's not terrible. I'm going to torque them to spec. I'm going to torque the bottom ones, torque the top ones to spec, and see where we're at. I'll be right back after I torque them, and we'll check the pull on that, and see if we're anywhere within spec. Be right back with you. Okay, guys, we've got all 8 bolts torqued down. 35 foot-pounds, and our bearings are lubed, and our knuckle is pivoting on them without any binding, without any trouble or anything, and that's good. Okay, now the way you test this is you get yourself a pull scale, and you're going to test this, and you're going to pull it, and you're going to be reading the pounds it takes just when that starts to break away. Not the actual breakaway pull, but when it breaks away and just starts its sweep, that's where you want to get between 12 and 16 pounds of pull on your scale. Right now I got 6 pounds of pull on that scale. That's way too loose. I'm going to remove these bolts, take some shims out, we're going to recheck it. But you're going to check it just by hooking in there, and you can check it both ways. You can put it to that side, and you can pull this way, and I like to get them toward the high side. When it's a brand new bearing, the spec is between 12 and 16 pounds of pull. I like to get them closer to 16, let everything wear in just nice. So I'm going to pull this cap, and I think I'll maybe take out 7 or 8 thousandths, and we'll try it again. And it's just a matter of pulling the cap and testing your pull. Now again, this is 3A, so it's only shimmed on the top. If this was a 2A and you shim top and bottom, and you wanted to take, say, 10 out, you take 5 from each. You keep the bottom and the top shim pack as close as you can on a CJ 2A. And that's critical. But again, this is 3A, so we're only shimmed on the top. A little bit easier. So let me get some shims out, and we'll recheck the pull on that. Okay, guys, this has been together and apart 7-8 times. We just can't get the preload we need on this. We took all the shims out, and because we're putting 11-inch brakes on here, we don't have that little brake hose guard that goes here. You know, your brake hose goes from here and picks up your wheel cylinder. So what I had to do was put some washers in here to make up for that, because the bolts were getting so long they were hitting the bearing. This is our last 10,000 shim that we can take out to try and tighten this up. If that doesn't work, what you need to do is get a washer that fits on that, so it'll hit the bearing sooner and tighten the bearing up, and then re-shim the whole thing again. It was standard practice. It's outlined in the service manual that if you can't get the preload, load the proper size washer in there, and then go at it. But you'll need to reshim the whole thing again. We're going to take this out. Right now we're right at 10 pounds of pull we had with that 10,000 shim in there. So hopefully we can pick up a little bit more with no shims in there. And if that's not the case, we'll machine a washer, stick it in there, do some calculations, reshim it, and see where the hell we're at. If you remember when I took this apart on one of the earlier videos, these knuckles were just flopping back and forth, and we're paying for it now. So hopefully with no shims in there, we're going to have enough to to get the proper preload, and hopefully the bolts won't be too long now with no shims in there. We've got the spacer to make up for that thing we took out. We got our lock washer in there, and we're going for it. So let me tighten these down, see where we're at, and I'll let you know what happens. Okay guys, we're at the position now where we have no more shims in the top, no shims anywhere. We've got everything torqued down, and we're gonna hook the scale, see what we get for a reading. I'm just getting 14 there, which is right within spec. Again, we wanted 12 to 16. So this side took absolutely, we started at 58, which was in there from the factory. And like I say, the last video when we took this apart, or not the last video, but an earlier one, these were just flopping. So things got worn out in there. We've got our brand new bearings, our brand new races. And that's just how it is. So you have to do what you need to do to make this right. You spend a couple hours now getting this right, and it'll be a world of difference going down the road. You know, you don't want something where the front end's wobbling around, and this is where a lot of that comes from, is your kingpin bearings. Take your time, get these right. Like I said, if that didn't work out, we'd put a washer in there and we'd reshim it again, and that would add extra push to that bearing and it would scrunch it tighter. And you just have to do what you need to do to make these right. So again, this is the 9th time we put this together. So, you know, we were creeping up on it, but it just wasn't building. And that feels real good now. When we add the seal and the axles in there and stuff, it'll be perfect. You can't have these too loose. They need to have the proper amount of pull on them. And it's critical. I'm going to see what happens on the next side. I'm going to put that together. I'm going to lube up some more bearings. Try that side, see where we are. And I'll let you know what the results are of that side. I won't bore you with all the details. Again, it's just putting it together, taking it apart, and, you know, putting it together and reading the pull. So that's basically how you do it. Let me get the other side done, and we'll talk more about that lube, and I'll show you a few more things about getting these things properly lubricated. Okay, I'll be right back with you. Okay, I've got the other side done now, and I started out with a 10,000 shim. It was just too much, so what I did was put a, I was going to put a spacer and show you that way, but it worked out at right at 16 pull pounds with no shims in there. So both sides are shimless right now, and this one worked out at 16 pounds of pull, and the other one at 14, so I'm happy with that. And after you do a bunch of these, you'll get a good feel for what it should feel like. But if it's your first time, use the scale, and just keep working at it till you get it right. Now, next time we're going to talk about axle shafts. I'm not going to get into that today, but we're going to talk about axle shafts next time. There's a lot of different things to know about those, and what you want to make sure of before you put these knuckles on. As you see that thrust washer in there, you want to make sure that's in good shape. Let me see if you can see the other one better. You want to make sure that's in good shape, because the axle shaft is going to depend on that. Okay, I think you can see that one. Before you put the knuckle on or do anything, make sure that's okay, and put a new one of those in there if you need it. You know, don't have that one be worn. So we're gonna talk about that next time. And right now I'm gonna show you the different lube I have for the knuckles, and I'll talk a little bit about lubricating the knuckles, the Bendix joint or the Spicer joint or the Zeppa joint, and keeping your bearings lubed up too. So let's go over to the bench and see what I got there. Okay guys, I know there's a lot of talk about knuckle lube and what's the right stuff to use and this and that, and a lot of controversy about that stuff. The original stuff that was in there, It just isn't available anymore. Very thick type of grease that flowed real nice. That is not available anymore, but I do have a lubricant company that is making some stuff for me. And I had some specialists out here. We looked at all the different U-joints. We looked at the bearings. We looked at everything. And here is what... I just got a little bit of it here in my hands. You can see, this is what I use in the summertime. I fill the knuckle with this stuff here. It's got a nice consistency. This is a lithium base material. And you can see the thickness of it there. Okay, now this stuff will run from minus 40 degrees to right around 400 degrees. So it covers everything. It's going to lubricate a Bendix joint, a Spicer joint, any kind of joint in there. It's going to splash lube into your bearings. Everything's going to be alright with that. You guys that just run your vehicles in the summer, that's a good lube to use. It really gets on everything. It's the proper stuff to use. It doesn't leak out real bad. It's thick enough, like I say, for getting in there and lubricating, you know, even those Bendix type joints. Okay, now for the guys that are running cold weather stuff, like I've got that snowblower Jeep that I'm going to be using, okay, and that's only going to operate probably in a cold weather. And I've got some material here that was made for me, and I think you'll be able to see this. This will actually run. This is, you see that running off my fingers there? Okay, this is a lot looser than the other stuff. Still a lithium base, but it's a lot looser, and this stays fluid like this to minus 60 degrees. And it'll run up to about 320 degrees Fahrenheit. Okay, so that's what I use in stuff that's going to really operate in cold conditions. If you got a plow Jeep, if you got something like I said, that snowblower Jeep I'm building, something you know is going to be in a cold weather, that's the stuff I like to use. For an all-around stuff, you know, I take this, the first stuff we looked at, and I take a little bit of this second stuff and I mix up a nice blend for, you know, year-round use, and it works real nice. And I have this stuff available now. I'm just starting to send out my first few orders, guys that want it. I've been using it for a little bit. It works real good. It doesn't break down. It's not going to come flying out of your knuckles there and screw everything up and make a mess in your garage or anything. It's the right viscosity, and it has good lubricating qualities. So the knuckle lube is available, and just get a hold of me, write a comment, or send me an email directly, and I can get you set up with some if you need it. And like I say, this is finally the right stuff out there that's being made specifically for antique vehicles and stuff, and it works wonderful. So next time, maybe I can show you lubing up the transmission transfer case. I'll show you the proper oil I've got for that. Like I say, I've got a whole new line of lubricants coming out. I'm not a lube scientist or engineer or anything like that. That's why I brought some people in. We looked at all the old gears. We looked at the steering boxes, the way it's a worm and tube type thing. I've got the proper lube for that. So I've got you guys covered if you need anything. And there'll be more talk about the lubrication as we start to lube the Jeep up. But if you have any questions or need more information on any of this stuff, just send me a comment or get a hold of me. Okay, guys, I think we got a little more time to talk about these axle shafts. And hopefully I got enough battery power to film everything. Now, this is a... this is a World War II style. That's called a tractor joint. They weren't too bad. They were pretty durable. But like you'll see on MBs and CJ2As, you're going to have a threaded end here. And what you did You basically wanted this to run, you know, it wanted a certain clearance in there. Okay, and that was set with shims on your hub. So you got your hub here and you'd shim it. Okay, and then you'd put your cap on there, and that would go, your axle shaft would go in there, and you'd put a nut on that, and by the amount of shims you had, when you put your nut on, this would pull to a certain point, you know, because you got shims behind there, and that would set your running clearance in there. And that worked pretty good. You know, you shimmed it, and there's specifications for how to go about doing that in a service manual and stuff. And you'd shim it, and you'd have the proper running clearance, and everything worked out pretty good. And that wasn't a bad system. But soon after, the freewheeling hubs started coming into play. And people would buy the freewheeling hubs, and they would cut their threads off. And now this has nowhere... it doesn't know where it wants to be. It could go in and out. And there was a whole lot of axle shaft failures, I guess you'd call them, because they had the hubs on there and they got a few more miles to the gallon, but once you cut those threads off, you're in trouble. Now, a shaft like this with threads on it, let me get a spindle here. And you see this spindle? This is your bushing here. You know, this is gonna ride in here like this. Okay. Now, an axle shaft with threads on it, there's not gonna be any flange on there. Okay, it's just gonna be a bushing that goes in there because you want this to be able to slide in and out. You don't want this bushing to hit up against anything. Okay, so when you have your threaded axle shaft, kind of difficult to get the bushings anymore because it wasn't for very long that they had them like this. Most guys sell them with the flange on them here. So if you can't get one with just a bushing, you know, just chuck it up in a lathe and cut that off if you have an early axle shaft with the threads on it. So that's the first style. And again, you controlled your end ply with the threads. And then later on, like on this 3A, we've got this Bendix style. And you see, you know, that has to run at a certain, you know, you're out there, you got trouble, and you're too close in, you got trouble. You know, it has to run at a certain distance. Now, all this was figured out at the factory where they made the axle shafts. So, if you remember, I said make sure that thrust washer in your housing was good. This area right here is what runs against that thrust washer in the case. Okay, so you got that running up against the case. You've got your flange bearing, and that bearing runs up against this. Okay, so when you send that through, you're kind of sandwiched in the right place because both of them are up against a bearing surface. So when you look on the front here, there's no area for a snap ring, there's no threads on it, there's nothing going on there. That is just going to run properly, or it's not. If it's not running properly, you probably got some issues with the thrust washers or your spindle bushing. You know, this can be worn down. So this Bendix, it's a little finicky, you know, it wants to be set up right. And you got to make sure your thrust washer and your spindle bearing are in good shape. And when that happens, it's going to run at the perfect spot, and you won't have any trouble with these. And that new knuckle lube that we got will certainly lubricate those balls in there just right. Okay, now as time went on, you got this spicer style joint, and this is just wonderful because you don't have to set any in and out play. That's fixed right there. So the inner thrust washer is still in the cases, but it's not used. There's nothing for it to run up against. Okay, you're going to basically put that shaft in, and you're still going to have the same kind of spindle bearing with the flange on it. Okay, now that's going to set that just right. Then you're going to put your hub or your drive flange on or whatever. And then what they have here, so things don't get moving around on you, there's a little groove around here. I think you can see that. And there's a little snap ring that goes on there. And that holds everything in perfect alignment and exactly where you want to be. So, I get a lot of questions about axle shafts and bushings and things like that. And guys sometimes make mistakes putting them in. And they put one axle shaft in when they should have a different one. And I just wanted to give you a little history on what they did with the axle shafts. And like I say, you know, if you have the original threaded style, I don't like to cut the threads off to put hubs on. I'd rather just have that front axle turning all the time, because it's kind of whipping the lube in there and slinging it around and sending it up to that top kingpin bearing. When you put the hubs on and you're freewheeling, you know, nothing's moving around in there. You're not slinging that lube around to that upper bearing. So just be aware when you're putting your axle together, especially your front axle, and you're trying to get everything right, just be aware of the different styles and the different ways they kept the alignment if you don't have a spicer joint. And just be aware of what's happening there. It's very easy to mess up a Bendix joint or even a spicer. You know, if you don't get these in there correctly, you don't have the right spindle bushing in and things are moving around, it's easy to mess things up in there. So just pay attention to what style you have, and make sure you get it shimmed right, or make sure your bushings are right, and when you get them in right, they're gonna last a long, long time. So before we actually put these in, we're gonna finish up the ring and pinion in that front end. Then we're gonna lube the knuckle. We're gonna put the seals on and lube the knuckle from the outside. We're gonna send the shaft in there, lube the shaft as it goes in, and we'll be good for a long, long time. So that's coming next time. Hopefully we'll have some parts. We'll set up the ring and pinion, we'll slide the axle shafts in, and we'll do some lubing of the knuckle, and that's where we're gonna leave off today. So hope it wasn't too boring learning about the different kind of axle shafts. Hope you guys are getting something out of it. And if you like it, hit the like button, subscribe, send me a comment, let me know what you think. Anything else you want to see, just give a shout and I'll try and get it out there for you. But we're going to continue on with this 3A restoration, and we should have it rolling pretty soon. Just need a few parts, and we'll get these things wrapped up and rolling pretty soon. Okay, we'll catch you next time. Thanks for watching.